If your doctor puts your future potential fertility over your current physical, mental, and emotional health, it's time to get a new doctor. I'm here to talk to you about ways to stop your period completely. Some of these use hormones, some of them don't, some of them are permanent, some of them are temporary. I'm just gonna go through them really quick. I'm gonna talk about birth control pills, the Mirena implant, the injection, the Implanon rod implant, endometrial ablation, and hysterectomies, both partial and full. So that's seven methods. So the first one is the pill. You might all be saying, yeah, Britta, we all know about the pill. But just make sure you talk to your doctor about why you want it. Because if you just say, hey, I want to go on the pill, they might just put you on a generic brand. Some pills you have to take the 3 weeks of hormones and then the 1 week of placebo and so on and so forth. You can't just keep taking the hormones the entire time. Also, if you take the triphasal ones, they won't work either and they'll probably mess with your hormones a bit more as well. So say, look, I want to be on this specifically for the point of stopping my periods. Whether or not you have super heavy bleeding or whether or not you have PMS, shouldn't affect it, but if you're really worried about what your doctor's gonna say, you can say my periods are super, super heavy and really painful. Whether they are or not shouldn't really be anyone's business. I don't think anyone should feel ashamed of wanting to stop their periods if they think, oh, you know, they're not that bad. Because the whole time I was a teenager, I thought, oh, this must be how everyone felt. And then I found out that, you know, some people never missed a day of school or work because of their periods. People would be like, oh, I had to sit on the couch with a hot water bottle after work. I'm like, you got to go to work? You could physically get out of bed without collapsing on the ground in agony? That's a thing. Most doctors should really be professional about it and prescribe it to you, regardless of how your periods are. But for me personally, I've been diagnosed with dysmenorrhea, which just means really painful periods in Latin. I don't know. And also I have premenstrual dysmorphic disorder, which means that my PMS is super bad as well. They're just all words for Britta's periods are really horrible. So that's fun. The second one I want to talk about, and my personal favorite, and the one that I'm on right now, is the Mirena implant. It's this tiny plastic tea business that excretes some kind of synthetic hormone that's not found in the human body. It's tiny, 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 and it can stay in your body for up to 5 years. Not like it dissolves or anything, you need to get it removed, but the hormones are meant to last 5 years. For me, they only last 2.5. Or kind of like 2 before my period started coming back again. So I had to get it replaced earlier, which was a bit of a hassle because my gynecologist didn't believe that it was because the hormones were running out in the Mirena. So I got a new gynecologist. You can always change medical practitioners. This is probably easier for someone who's over the age of 18, but you know, if your doctor or gynecologist isn't working for you, see another one. That's what I did. It's like, oh, you're not gonna replace my Mirena, I'll see someone else. And I told someone else and she's like, yeah, I believe your periods have come back after 2.5 years. That's totally possible. And she replaced it for me and hey, voila, 2 months later, my period stopped. So it was the Mirena running out of hormones. What I'm trying to say with that ramble is not all medical practitioners are the same and not all are coming at things with the same amount of education and knowledge. Some people say you know your body best and some people say no you don't, doctors do. I think it's a balance of both, but I really think that, you know, doctors should listen to us about our bodies a bit more. So I got it implanted or inserted under general anesthesia, and this is because my cervix is super tight, so they couldn't actually get it in while I was awake. Apparently this is like 2 in every 20 or 30 people who get it inserted need to get it while they're asleep because our cervixes are really tight. I got it inserted a couple of days after my period, and then the next period after that was 10 days long and really heavy, so that was shit. But the period after that was super light. I think I used one tampon on like the second day and then nothing, it was just spotting. And then after that, no periods for 2 years, which was brilliant. I wish someone had told me about this earlier. Because it's a very small percentage of people with uteruses that experience really debilitating period pains, other people who get their periods that aren't that bad kind of don't believe us, and that's really shitty. All bodies are different and they react differently, and if your period's stopping you from living your life, even if it's just 1 or 2 days a month, then, you know, that shit adds up. I was going to talk about the injection and the rod implant, but that would require me to know something about them, and I don't even know if they stop your periods or not, so oops. But Google it. There's an injection in your arm with hormones every 3 months, and there's like a rod you can get implanted. I've heard the rod can snap if you have a super active lifestyle, which is why I didn't get it, because my lifestyle is hella active. Those are the hormonal ways to stop your periods. There are also three, I don't know if the first one's considered surgical, but I'm going to call it surgical anyway. There's three surgical ways to get rid of your periods as well, if for some reason you can't go on hormones, or if they're not working for you. The first one's called endometrial ablation, where they put a rod inside you and a little net gets cast out in your uterus and electrocutes the inside of your uterine lining and then gets pulled out, and that electrocuted scar tissue heals up, but because it's scar tissue, it doesn't function like it normally does, so the egg can't attach to it and it doesn't build up all its mucousy bloody good stuff. In theory, if your uterine wall has been electrocuted off, basically burnt off, it shouldn't function anymore. I also know of people who swear by it. Other people have had really bad pains from the scarring. That's the downside of the surgical options, is you can have really bad pains from the internal scarring and there's not much you can do. I know someone who got a hysterectomy and had really bad pains from the scarring for several years. And, you know, it was worse than what they were getting from their periods. So they're like, why did I do this? After that had settled down, they were fine from then on. But yeah, so talking about hysterectomies, there's a partial and a full. So the partial leaves your ovaries there. Your ovaries are these little bits that produce testosterone, androgens, progesterones, and estrogens. Obviously a bit less of the first two and a bit more of the second two is generally how ovaries function, but they produce all the hormones that are considered sex or gender hormones, and they travel around your body and kind of make things work. If you leave your ovaries in, if they don't have cysts on them and there's no like cancerous stuff going on, there's no reason to remove your ovaries, so you can get a partial hysterectomy. I know someone who got that and has never had their period since, which is super cool. They still get PMS though, because their ovaries still secrete the hormones cyclically. So if PMS is something you really want to avoid as well, then that might not really be for you. And the last one is full hysterectomy. So they get rid of everything. If they do that, you will need to be on hormone replacement for the rest of your life, because you will stop producing your own hormones. Some people can just go without hormones for a while, but it's meant to be really bad for things. Hormones do things in your body. So I hope that was kind of informative. I just personally wish someone had told me about Mirena earlier. And, you know, I had really, really bad pains for, you know, what am I, 25? So 14 years, minus the couple of years I've been on Mirena. And, you know, it was stopping me from doing stuff, you know, doing sports, going to work, you know, the amount of money that I've lost because I had to call in sick to work and I didn't have sick days. It adds up. Getting Mirena cost me between $200 and $400, depending on where I went, if I went private or not. I went to two different places the two times I got it. But, you know, that seems like a lot of money. $400 for this implant thing? Well, yeah, but the amount of money I was losing every month from not working because I couldn't, it quickly builds up, especially if you consider that that $400 lasts between 2.5 and 5 years, depending on how your body reacts to the Mirena. I hope this helped you, and if you have any questions, ask me down here. I usually reply within a day or two, so see ya.